some tender nipples. Next sign usually is that they will begin to swell up a bit. You will have some kind of puffy nipples. So, after some time now on this channel, I figured most of these viewers are actually all on some kind of gear. But I thought we had to go back to some basics, because some of the questions I'm getting show a little bit of lack of knowledge on the pharmacodynamics and pharmacology of certain steroids and how they work. So in this video, we will address how you take care of estrogen, estradiol, E2, estrogen, whatever you'll call it, and what kind of compounds that is available for you guys out there to use to keep those things in check. This is purely entertainment. It is not educational. I'm not a doctor. I'm not your doctor. You should see a physician by any kind of medical advice you want. You should see a professional. You shouldn't ask me. You shouldn't do what I do. This is just for entertainment. Whatever. Don't do what I do. Let's continue. So first off, let's talk about what E2 estradiol actually is. So estradiol is just a term for all kinds of estrogens that you have in your body. When we are talking about this, I'll just call it E2 or estrogen or whatever. And I will currently refer to all the kinds of estrogen in our bodies as men. Because what we are going to talk about today is if your titties are beginning to grow, if they are tender, and if you are concerned if you are developing some kind of gynecomastia. So let's start off with what is gyno actually. First off, gyno doesn't go away. Gyno is hard tissue that is forming under your glands. Just like with girls, it will never go away. What are the signs that you are getting gynecomastia? The first sign is, of course, you are getting some tender nipples. Next sign usually is that they will begin to swell up a bit. You will have some kind of puffy nipples. They will be showing in your t-shirt. All kinds of really bad signs you don't want to deal with. That is the first way to notice. The second thing is, what I prefer and what I would recommend everyone is doing, please get some blood work done once in a while so you can see where it is. Because not everyone will get sore nipples or puffy nipples while they are developing gynecomastia. So please take care of this, guys. Note this, if you don't have sore nipples and if you don't have puffy nipples, it doesn't mean that you are currently not developing some kind of gynecomastia. So, how do we get elevated estrogen in the first place? So in this video, we will only talk about our bioidentical hormone, testosterone, and how it works. So we have this enzyme called aromatase in our body. Just as if you watch my hair videos, we have the 5-alpha-reductase enzyme. We also have something called aromatase. Now, aromatase takes the testosterone and converts it into estrogen. So of course, I hope if you follow this, that if you increase your testosterone, well, since some of it is converting into estrogen via the aromatase enzyme, of course, with elevated testosterone, you will also elevate your estrogens in your body. At some point, you will reach a threshold where you will begin to stimulate your glands to develop breast tissue or female tissue, whatever you'll call it, and you will get titties in the end. Now let's talk about how you can prevent the increase in estrogen. So in this video, we are just going to stick with the basics and we will go over three compounds that is the most known compounds on there. It is first off tamoxifen, also known as Nolvadex. We have the anastrozole, also known as Adex, and the exemestane, also known as aromycin. Each of these compounds has their own effects and way to work, and usually there are some reasons to use one over another. So I have some of them that I prefer to use, and depending on the situation, there are circumstances where I will switch them out for something else. The first one we are talking about is the Nolvadex. Nolvadex is something in its own class. It is what's called a SERM, which is a selective estrogen receptor modulator. So what it actually does is that it binds to the receptor and changes how the receptor can bind to other hormones, meaning that it can bind now to the estrogen. When it can bind to estrogen, estrogen won't have the function it's supposed to have, meaning that you have just blocked estrogen from doing its job. Now, Nolvadex, tamoxifen, whatever we'll call it, is what I call the handbrake or the emergency brake when you're doing steroids. If you, for some reason, just fucked up your cycle and you're having problems, this is a drug that can inhibit estrogen activity pretty fast, but also, as I just said, it is a receptor modulator. It is not an anti-estrogen. So it will not fix the problem. You will still have high estrogen in your body and it will still do a lot of damage to you. But you can stop it from working temporarily while you fix the problem. This is the only use that I think tamoxifen has in a cycle at all. The second one is what's called anastrozole, also known as the Adex. Anastrozole is a second generation aromatase inhibitor. This means that instead of blocking on the receptor path, it actually inhibits the enzyme aromatase we just talked about from doing its job. Meaning that when you elevate your testosterone, aromatase won't be able to take some of the testosterone and convert it to estrogen because you have decreased the amount of aromatase enzyme that you have available in your body. The way anastrozole works is by binding to the aromatase enzyme, thus making it unavailable to bind with the testosterone, and by that way it will not convert the testosterone anyway. There's only one problem in my opinion when using anastrozole, and that is it has a tendency to increase the bad lipid profile and decrease the good lipids. So in the end, your lipid profile will get skewed at some point. The third option and the most recent there is exemestane, also known as aromasin. So exemestane has one feature that is pretty good about it. That is that it's a type 1 aromatase inhibitor, while anastrozole is a type 2. It is what's called a reversible inhibitor. This meaning that actually if you don't get rid of aromatase enzyme, it will stick around and it will at some point become active again. Now for exemestane, it is the direct opposite. It is a type 2 and it's what's called a non-reversible suicidal steroidal inhibitor. This means that when you have taken exemestane, whatever job it has done is permanent. While taking anastrozole, the job is not permanent and it will reverse at some point. Hopefully, if you're using anastrozole, you are done with the cycle when you stop taking it. But this is also one of the reasons why it's not as effective as exemestane. Lastly, exemestane has shown to have a non-significant function on your lipid profile. This means that it won't reduce it to something bad and it won't elevate it or anything else like that. So while you use it, you don't have to be concerned about your cholesterol and what can happen to your blood and veins and heart and whatever, whatnot. Of course, there are loads of other things you have to be careful about when doing this kind of stuff. But at least if you are using exemestane, you have one thing less to worry about compared to if you are using Nolvadex, where you still have the estrogen in your body, or anastrozole, where it will reverse at some point again. Of course, the last thing missing is of course the dosages. How are you going to dose these things if you are using tamoxifen, anastrozole, exemestane, whatnot? And if you want to know more about that, just look in the description. The way that's usually the best way is of course by getting blood work done while you titrate around with this. And the second best option is to use some kind of dosages that has been known to work for most cycles, but there's no guarantee that it will work for you guys, and I don't think it's a really good choice. But of course, if you are going to make that choice, it is solely up to you guys. If you don't know how to titrate something, just use Google, something else like that. It's going to be a hassle for me to explain over here, and I'm pretty sure that there's someone out there who is way better than me and explaining what titrating actually is. So, until next time guys, see ya, cheers.